Welcome back to Ucypher and Sport, Nai Superstars. After the game 3, the Marksmen are at 6 and Crusaders are at 5. Up next, we have the last game of the day, Dota 2.
Get a ban. Ten seconds.
Five. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Ucypher. This is the last game of Round Robin 2. It's been a long, exciting journey, but Crusaders, this is pretty much the end of the road for them. And let's hope that they can go out with one final huge bang. Now, this might be the last time we see Remstar or Atul play on the main stage. I hope it's not. Let's see that the Crusaders can show that they're a good team to everyone here.
Yeah, just like the dinosaurs went extinct, sure as hell, Crusaders, Indian Dota dinosaur Remstar is going to be stepping off the stage after this particular match. Crusaders, they're going to open up the draft with the Visage and the Nyx Assassin bans. Marksmen are going to go with the Doom and that Ancient Apparition. I mean, you and I have been left scratching our heads about what the hell that Doom is doing in the first phase, but it's something that's unique to you, Cypher. Marksmen have recognized that this is a hero that poses a threat, especially given when you're trying to end the game, go up onto the high ground, but unable to do so in the first 40 minutes. Marksmen will ban that Ancient Apparition alongside him as well. So we're possibly looking at a Necroforce pick, maybe the old school Undying Medusa that many teams have chosen to run in the past. Crusaders, on the other hand, will ban out the Earthshaker. This leaves in the staple first pick, aka the Lich.
Yep, staple first pick, aka the Lich, is in the pool. We'll see Spectre getting banned out in the first phase. The Earthshaker ban probably suggests that Bakemono might want to go to the jungle. He's been the only player in this tournament who's played Chen or Enchantress, if I'm not mistaken. He's largely been playing the Earth Spirit.
And there it is.
They're going to stick with the Earth Spirit for Bakemono.
You know, at this point, when the stakes are basically non-existent for Crusaders, you probably just pick to have fun. So everyone's probably just going to ask what they want to play. The captain's going to pick what they want. And maybe they're just going to go out having some fun here.
Yep.
5 seconds. Marksmen, remaining. On the other hand, I don't think they should take this game lightly, because even though they are secure a slot in the semi-finals, it's tough to practice on. You're on the main stage, you're playing against a competitive team, you've got your 5 on a land setting, you might as well use this as a grounds to practice and get better going into the semi-finals.
Yeah.
It's also about sending a message to the other teams that may be trailing them or maybe watching them. Because let's face it, word is going to get out about what happens on the stage. The other teams are going to be keeping their eyes and ears open to the best of their ability. And if Marksmen can assert their dominance here by taking a convincing victory, who knows, they might force out a few fake bans as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's something that the Marksmen could force here. The thing is, the Marksmen, and this is actually good, is that, look, this could have easily been an opportunity for them to give the Devil Jinpachi some play on the main stage. But they're sticking with the 5 that's going into the playoffs. And they want to practice with that 5. They want to work out the small kinks, the small issues that they're facing as a team. And they're going to switch things up. They're picking up the Dazzle, a hero that I haven't seen in a while. Now, Poison Touch was reworked. Apparently, if you attack an enemy attacked by the Poison Touch, the debuff applies again.
I'm not entirely certain if that's a talent or if it's just an innate ability that's been given over to him, but either way, it's a viable reason to pick him up. Night Stalker's gonna come out, Marksmen have run this time and again, and if it ain't broke, don't fix it, but Crusaders immediately responding with that Tidehunter pickup. How could they not have seen this coming? Marksmen should have possibly picked it up for themselves. Because I don't think the Night Stalker and the Dazzle are enough to deal with the Tide anymore.
Yeah, you could have done Tide and Night Stalker. I mean, Marksmen had that opening if they wanted to. But they've gone for the Dazzle in the first phase. Now, picking up the Dazzle doesn't give away too much, but Dazzle is something that can be picked up later.
Yeah, it's not like he was going to get banned.
Yeah, especially when there's so many stronger heroes in the pool, Dazzle's not going to get banned. And now that you picked up the Dazzle, if the Crusaders wanted to, they could have picked up something that kind of shuts him down. Now, there's no space for an axe. so that you have the Culling Blade that goes through the grave. They picked up the Tidehunter, but
I think
this is a grave error the teams are making in that draft. They sometimes get so caught by banning heroes which are strong in the tournament, and they forget to account for heroes which are actually strong in the game.
That said though, Marksmen might have tunnel visioned on, you know, they don't have a way, they don't have a way to deal with heals, and we can just pick up heal bombs. They'll start with the Dazzle because of the Ancient Apparition ban, which kind of makes sense, but like you said, the Dazzle could be picked up later. But I'm a little surprised that Crusaders have chosen not to ban out heroes like the Necroforce and the Undying here.
Yeah.
They chose to ban out the Juggernaut. Healing Ward is another heal that could have gone over to the Marksmen. It's not a bad ban. But at this point, I would certainly ban the Necroforce if I was on the side of Crusaders. I don't want to go up against the Necroforce and the Dazzle in that lineup. He's going to survive through the Ravage. He's most likely not going to go down to the Earth Spirit next to him as well. And if the Dazzle so much as stands a pace behind him, he's going to get the Grave on him long enough for him to pop a Ghost Charge, One Charges, and the Death Pulse. And he's back up to full HP. Marksmen have the third pick on the board here. And the Luna has been banned out, so Necroforce is still in the mix if they want to get it. At the same time, I wouldn't be too much against Crusaders picking up the Necroforce for themselves. It's some more tankiness thrown on top of that already tanky Tidehunter and the Earth Spirit pickup.
I'd actually like to see Crusaders pick up a really mobile mid laner who could just jump on top of the Dazzle and shut him down before he even gets that Grave off. They could pick up the Necroforce like you mentioned on the side of the Crusaders, but then you got to be careful. Like, I mean, you could throw out the Reaper Sight and there's an instant heal coming out from the Dazzle. A Grave coming out from the Dazzle, and that could pretty much make your Reaper Sight useless. They're going to go with the Legion Commander. Strong offlaner here.
Decent healing as well.
Yeah.
Press the attack regeneration.
Press the attack as well. Which is the Dispel.
I was just going to get to that. One of the reasons why Legion holds a bit more value in these drops is because Dispel is sort of a rare, it's a scarce commodity now in Dota.
Yep.
You had the Diffuser Blade that could purge it off. That's no longer a thing.
There's only Oracle.
There's basically only Oracle and to a certain extent, the Legion Commander. I mean, sure, there's things like the Aeon Disc, which are so situational that you might want to consider ignoring them altogether.
So the Aeon Disc itself can be dispelled? The effect of the Aeon Disc can be dispelled. I was looking at Reddit today and there's a long thread discussing the Aeon Disc. I mean, some of these newer items are still struggling to find our way around them. The Dazzle pickup has been as explained by the Husker. And what I wanted to come back to is that the Aeon Disc can be dispelled. I mean, it's great on heroes like the Ember Spirit, who might need that extra 2 seconds to just remnant out or get the hell out of there. It's great for heroes that try to split push. It's not so good on the Husker, funnily enough.
Mostly because you shut your own self down and you can't auto-attack.
Yeah, you can't auto-attack. You don't take damage, but you don't do damage either. So you drop low, but you're not doing any damage with the right click. So you're just going to survive it. It's a wasted slot.
Oh, Crusaders. They've seen the Husker picked and raised them a Meepo. I like this.
Yeah.
I think this is a really neat way to deal with the lack of AoE control coming out from the Marksmen.
Yeah.
10 seconds.
It's an oversight on Marksman's part. I mean, they tunnel visioned on picking the Dazzle Husker duo. They set up the long game by banning the Ancient Apparition and first picking a Dazzle. They went for the Husker. Crusaders, it feels like they saw this coming from a mile away and just chose to respond with that Meepo pick. And now Marksmen have to be worried. I mean, the laning phase may not be so good for Crusaders, but if they can just hold their own for the first 10 minutes, Meepo's going to go into the jungle and farm. And once Meepo pulls out that Blink Dagger, Husker is as good of a target as any on the side of Marksmen. Last pick on the board for Marksmen, they should still be looking for a one position, assuming this is a mid Husker.
Turn to pick.
I mean, they have the option of running a one position Husker as well.
Yeah, I was thinking one position, but running him in the mid lane could work. It at least forced Meepo to constantly be sending one of his clones back to base every now and then and poofing them right back. Crusaders, they're looking for a one position themselves.
What's their option here? I mean, you want something mobile, you could get a Slark. If you want something that takes buildings, what's an option in that department? I mean, I was going to say the Luna or the Juggernaut, but both of them have been banned out. Sven's not an option. Phantom Assassin's not an option. There's actually been a lot of one-position bans this game.
Do you think safe lane Timbersaw?
It could work. the pure damage, the stat steal versus Huskar, the innate tankiness versus the Legion Commander. I like it. I think the one position Timbersaw could work here.
Yeah. And if the Timbersaw builds any on this, it's going to be a hard game. I also get a little bit of status resistance with the Aeon Disc, I think 20%. Do you know you can go about 100% status resistance?
So what, you don't get stunned at all?
No, you do. You do. So the time doesn't reduce beyond a point. Like you, so if it's an 8-second orchid, you still get it, you get affected by the orchid for only 2 seconds. We experienced it yesterday. Damn, it hurts. Like I don't know, we landed a call and then you zipped it on the storm. You thought everybody was dead, and then Pudge with status resistance just turns around and dismembers you, and then you end up dying.
Speaking of Pudge, is that an option here?
I don't know if they play Pudge. So, 1 second, what are we looking for? We're looking for a Remstar hero. He likes the Weaver.
He loves the Weaver. But the last time he played the Weaver, he kind of got punished for it.
You think Razor?
Not really a major fan of the Razor here.
Gyrocopter?
Gyro's nice. That's some AoE that'll add onto that Tidehunter. It's also a bit of physical damage that could work versus the Huskar in the late game stage. Magic damage versus the LC.
Do you realize how we're narrowing the hero pool based on what Remstar has played in the tournament?
I mean, it's unlikely he's going to be playing a Meepo here.
Yeah.
This should be the invincible mid Meepo.
Yeah, so it's going to be the invincible Meepo. I'm actually a little...
Okay then. No surprises here. Viper's going to be the final pick.
The Nether Toxin is going to do some work versus the Huskar.
Yeah. Break's not too shabby at all versus the Huskar versus the Legion as well.
10 seconds.
If I'm not mistaken, Hunter in the Night gets disabled as well.
5 seconds remaining.
So you drop a break on the Night Stalker and I believe you get slowed down for that duration.
Okay.
Monkey King. Marksman just going all in on the physical DPS department, and now they've got a versatile lineup. The Huskar and the Monkey King, either of them could go towards the middle lane and just do just fine versus the Meepo. I prefer the Huskar at mid, because if the Huskar's at mid, I'd assume that you're gonna have Pashu on the Dazzle rotating there from time to time as well.
I think it is the mid Huskar.
I mean, Zark has picked it up for now, so it's likely that it's a mid Huskar.
Would you like to see the Crusaders send... Do you think Meepo safe lane ever works? Are you against it? Do you think it's a wasted lane?
Not really. I mean, your supports have to be super active for it. In this case, they have two supports that are meant to move around the map. I don't see the Silencer as a pure babysitter support. I think Silencer is one that should be active around the map, trying to get the early intelligence seal going for him. And with the Earth Spirit, they've got the control, they've got the slows, they've got the double slows coming out with the curse as well. I think this could work, provided that Senjin and Bakemono leave the lane early on and just let Meepo do his thing versus what should be an offlane Legion Commander, which he's going to be fine against. The only problem with the safe lane Meepo is... might want to consider not picking up a bottle for the runes. But honestly, nowadays, I don't even see too many Meepos getting the bottle because the Shrine comes online at the first 5-minute mark. And that just lets you reset early on before you move into the jungle. Anyway, we're going to get into this game, and you know, I think it's only fitting that we do a final introduction for both sides, because this very well is Crusaders' final game on the Ucypher main stage for Season 1. On the side of the Dire, you have Bakemono handling that Earth Spirit. Darshan's going to be playing that Tidehunter. Senjin will be on the Silencer. Remstar on the Viper, and that puts Invincible on the Meepo.
Okay, hold on. My game just froze. I think I have to reconnect. Apologies. Yeah, you can carry on with the introductions.
That happens every now and then. But on the other side, Pashu is going to be playing the Dazzle. It's going to be red on the Legion Commander. Zark will be handling the Huskar. Itachi God on the Nightstalker, and Mage on the Monkey King. We always have this great Indian Dota pause coming out. Not really sure what the pause is about. I mean, most of the time they cite tech issues, but I think someone actually got up from their seat and left on the side of Crusaders.
Oh yeah, I see an empty seat. Not really sure whom. Last time around when they took a pause, it was for Senjin to visit the restroom. Okay.
Yep, he went to pee. I mean, our theory has been proven, right? Every time, these guys only figure out that the best time to go take a leak is when the draft is done. The great Indian Dota pearls. And this is the thing that's been happening across tournaments, across teams.
Every tournament in India, I'm pretty sure players just bind a hotkey to the pause command and they're just pressing that hotkey as soon as the game loads.
It's a tactical pause, man. Under the pretext of the washroom, they're gonna devise their early game strats and their smoke rotations.
Yeah. Like kids in school during exams running to the bathroom to look at their notes. Thoughts? Who do you think has really won this draft? I want to say that Crusaders might actually win this.
Yeah, Crusaders' draft isn't bad, but it's punishable.
It is.
It's very punishable.
They've got what it takes to deal with the Tide. The Monkey King is going to be just fine with that early point at Jingu Mastery. Meepo's going to have a hard time. He's going to be...
If anything, I think the Meepo's going to have a decent time this game.
What's the Husker?
There's not too many ways to actually, for lack of a better word, counter the Meepo.
Yeah.
I mean, you want to have something like a Disruptor that holds them in position, or you want to have a Tide for the multiple Meepo clone Ravage. Yeah. And Earthshaker, not entirely a counter because of the AoE damage, but more so because of the AoE stuns.
Mm-hmm.
None of that is available on the side of Marksmen, and that could be something that comes back to bite them later. Especially if Meepo gets a good start. An early Blink Dagger with some good rotations means Invincible will just walk all over them this game. His only threat is a Huskar surviving through the Poof and Geostrike combination, courtesy of the Dazzler's Grave, but that's something he'll be able to deal with once he gets his Scythe of Ice.
Well, since you play a lot of Meepo, what really makes a Meepo's life difficult? Having all four of them stunned up, is that what you need to deal with a Meepo? Or a lot of burst damage? Burst magical damage?
Burst damage, not so much. The disable is what hurts you.
Okay.
On the Meepo. Because by virtue of Meepo picking up stat items, you tend to get a fair bit of HP.
Okay.
Which means that burst isn't something you need to worry about too much. He gets a truck ton of armor as well, because eventually you're going to build agility items as well.
Yep.
The most annoying thing is when you're locked down, or when you're hit with something like a Savage Roar, or even a Global Silence for that matter, and you kind of have a hard time gaining control of what's going on in the midst of a battle.
Okay. Is that why they picked up the silencer? Just so that Meepo doesn't get locked down continuously?
I mean, we have seen Senjin run the silencer quite often in this tournament. So
yeah.
It's one of his favorites. I think it's just an added cherry on top that it works well with the Meepo in his own lineup.
So they are running the safe lane Meepo. That's what Invincible was plotting in the bathroom all this while.
Going for the double Wraith Band here.
Yeah.
So gonna get those early stats online.
30 seconds to battle.
Although, this sort of feels like he picked up two slippers, forgetting that the PMS is no longer available, and now just to cover his tracks, he's queued up double Wraith Band.
Yeah. He has moved into the lane with a somewhat short supply of consumables, but look at this, Marksmith. Not the earliest of aggression, but they are moving to contest the rune. This is what happens more times than not, and it's going to be securing the rune, not contesting the rune.
This is another one of those things that doesn't really make sense to me, but what they've done is they've left Mage on the bottom side this time around. Unfortunately, Mage didn't walk in there in time, else he'd have been able to zone out Darshan and pick up another bounty rune for himself.
Mm-hmm.
But they get a ward placed down next to the bounty rune spot. Senjin has a sentry, but it's unlikely he's going to get the D ward off, because that ward is not really blocking any camps, so it's not going to give away its position. Zark, he is going to be on the middle lane versus Remstar's Viper. I think Viper is one of those that can actually deal with Zark,
yeah,
but not when the Dazzle's in the vicinity as well.
This is just disgusting. They're running the Dazzle with the Husker in the mid lane. This means that the Monkey King, I mean, he's going to do okay versus the Tide. He can be able to push the Tide out of lane if nothing else.
I mean, Remstar just hasn't been able to catch a break, right? Even the last time he played the Weaver, he was met with an aggressive tri-lane. Now he's being met on the middle lane by a dual lane. How disgusting is this?
Yep, it's not a talent. Anytime the target gets attacked, the debuff duration is refreshed.
Okay, that's awful. Is it just an attack by the Dazzle, or is it attacks by anyone? Anytime he gets attacked. Okay, great. So that means does damage over time from Burning Spears refresh the duration of Poison Touch again and again?
I don't know. If it does, this is just an awful lane for Remstar altogether.
Bakemono is waiting in the trees here. Has that rolling boulder if he wants to try and come in. But I just don't see a kill taking place here, especially not while Invincible is in level 1. But now he's got level 2. Well, he's almost got level 2. First, the next level 2 Meepo. They're thinking of going in. The rolling boulder's there. Invincible spawns. Well, he picks up the Earthbind and catches him in place. One poof and an auto attack. Senjin gets the first blood kill.
Yep.
Along with the stolen intelligence.
Good stuff coming out from the Crusaders here. The result of this match has no real significance in the long run, but they're still fighting. And Bakemono even rolls aggressively trying to steal the bounty rune, and he's going to do just that. It's still a rune for red and a rune for Bakemono.
Mm-hmm.
The Night Stalker wasn't nearby and wasn't there to punish Bakemono and the Earth Spirit. Mid lane, Remstar's having a really hard time. Husker's just winning this lane and how.
You think that's bad? You should see bottom. Mage is just walking all over Darshan right now. 14-3 CS versus 5-0 of a Tidehunter who's got a creep wave under his tower. Talk about underwhelming. Pashu's also joined the party here, so Darshan might get zoned out of the lane once. He started with a fair bit of regen though, so he can stay alive in the lane, but that only works if Mage doesn't connect with one of those fancy boundless strikes.
I think Darshan walked into the lane with two mangoes. I mean, he's completed his wand and he still has another mango.
I'm not a fan of him putting the second point into Kraken Shell before skilling up the Anchor
Smash. You think
Anchor
Smash versus the Monkey King in lane is a lot better? I agree. It actually allows you to somewhat try and win this lane. Now it's gonna get harder. Pashu's here. Mage is just walking up to Darshan.
No Orb of Venom on Mage though, so the extra slows aren't gonna come out. Pashu, I don't even think he should bother trying to auto-attack Darshan and zone him out. He's taking more damage than he's dishing out.
Yeah. And he did it when Mage was busy dealing with the creep, so Mage can't even make it in time to try and get any damage done on this Tidehunter.
Mm-hmm.
Red isn't doing too bad. He's level 3, but it looks like he could go up on it. They've got the Earthbind, they've held the lead to Commander. Blaze, Rolling Boulder to follow, Boulder Smash to follow that up. With Last Word and Arcane Curse, Invincible gets the kill. Senjin steals Intelligence.
Red shouldn't even be in the lane at this point. He's picked up a Quelling Blade on the Legion Commander. Just get into the jungle and farm over there.
Yeah.
When the creep wave comes under your tower, that's when you can consider soaking up some EXP. There's no point trying to contest the Meepo this early on. The only thing they're doing is accelerating his farm rate. And they're making matters worse by giving Senjin Intelligence. That makes a 5-position silencer all the more relevant going into the mid game.
Mm-hmm.
Red, he's got eyes on Bakemono once again, but
did Bakemono steal the rune? No, he didn't.
I don't think he did.
I saw Red pick it up.
Generous!
Mage. Bottom lane, he's on 25 CS. He's keeping pace with the Meepo, but Meepo's gonna be ahead in terms of net worth. Actually, it's Mage that's ahead in terms of net worth. Nope, they're neck and neck. The one kill and one assist on Invincible is gonna accelerate his farm rate a bit as well, and he's also got himself 2 points in the poop, so he can push out the waves, go into the jungle, and set that farming rhythm for himself to pull further and further ahead.
Mm-hmm. And
Mage, Remstar's dead.
Yeah, boulder smash a bit too late. Itachi got just ran him down in the first night time. Remstar, with very little vision on the Night Stalker, ends up falling.
It's 2-1. It's still Crusaders that have the kill score lead, but the net worth charts are slightly tilted in favor of Marksmen. Their Monkey King and Husker are to blame for this. They're both farming very efficiently, while the Viper, he's actually been destroyed in the lane here.
Yeah, the Night Stalker has more net worth than the Viper. That's a horrible indicator of, it's the truth, right? Remstar's just losing his lane time and time again.
Look, it's very straightforward here. Invincible's job is to carry the entire weight of his team on his shoulders. Crusaders have made it clear, this is your game to shine. Go out there, be the star kid that we need you to be in. Carry us to victory.
So, Invincible was really good in his first game, in round robin 1, in his first game in the tournament, if I'm not mistaken. He played an Ember Spirit and how. There were signs of new talent really coming in. And that's what Invincible made all of us feel back then. But since then, he's been rather lackluster. He hasn't had too much impact. He sort of wins the lane, but doesn't do too much after that.
I mean, I don't want to say it's entirely his fault as well, because as a unit, nice. Crusaders haven't been very impressive either.
Yeah.
They've just been disconnected. There's a complete lack of leadership. Their players aren't stepping up when needed. Occasionally, it's Bakemono that's making misplays in the early game, and other times it's Remstar that's not farming efficiently. And like you said, sometimes even Invincible does have a bad spot. Most of this stems from the fact that they're not on the same page with each other, but at least this game, they're showing something different, right? They've rallied behind Invincible, letting him do his thing, stacking the jungle for him as and when they can, giving him a safe lane on the top side, while everyone else's job is to simply survive to the best of their abilities, while Invincible comes online.
Invincible, I think he's spotted out Red. Red.
Yeah, this is a
good. He's not got a TP. Arcane Curse, Earthbind. Even if he had the TP with Bakemono rolling in, there's no way he got out of it.
2-0-1, Invincible still pulling forward on this Meepo. He's choosing not to rush the Blink Dagger though. He's going for the Dragon Lance first up. Two Raid Bands and a Dragon Lance. He's going to be hitting harder than anyone else on this map.
Yeah, and they recognize this. They're TPing in the Monkey King to the top lane. The only problem is this Dire Observer.
Beautifully
spotted everything else. Sends in, setting up Invincible's retreat, but Mage is here with the Boundless Strike. The Boundless Strike slips onto the Monkey King, sends in, hitting from the high ground. Invincible dropping low, but Darshan with the Ravage keeps his Meepo alive. In fact, he poofs. He brings down Mage, but Red manages to find a kill in response. Red still not level 6, doesn't have the duel. Him and Itachi are on the retreat while Pashu dies elsewhere. Darshan giving chase, but without the Gush, it's unlikely he closes the gap. Bakemono pops the shrine, turns towards the Legion Commander, drops the Boulder Smash and the Geomagnetic Grip, and they're body blocking him. They're not letting him reach his own shrine. Heck, there's even a range creep who joins in on the action. The last word upon Red, and Remstar joins the battle. A haste rule will ensure that he gets an assist and ensures that Senjin gets a lot more intelligence to work with.
Yeah, that fight was also augmented by the fact that Senjin's been stealing intelligence throughout. He stayed alive from start to finish. He's now got 12 stolen intelligence. He's put the dunce cap on multiple heroes and he's made himself a tad bit smarter. Staying alive also gives him a little bit of money to work with now. Still quite far behind in terms of net worth, but he's got his boots, he's got his magic stick, and he can buy a few more 5-position support items.
I think what was a big decider in that team fight was the fact that Darshan didn't die in the bottom lane, and that allowed him to hit 6 before Red and the Legion Commander.
Yep.
Darshan held on to a TP, just TP'd in at the right time, was at the right place, popped the Ravage and ensured that Invincible at least got a kill before he ended up falling. Now they're smoked up. This is without the Ravage. They know that the Huskull is going to be a problem come mid and late game, and they need to deal with this. Bakemono leading the charge, still not level 6. They're waiting for the Husker to show in late. But Zark.
Problem is, they're going in without a Ravage this time. That could come back to hurt them.
Well, they're basically trying to find Invincible a kill. They know that Rem might have just fallen back into the jungle.
Yeah, they've got
the and they've got them. The Earthbinds are there. There is a Radiant Shrine. But there's no DPs for the Legion Commander. Poof, poof, poof. He pops the shrine and down he goes. Senjin on a killing spree. 14 stolen intelligence.
This auto transition into a tier 1 tower on top as well. But they could contest this. I mean, Monkey King has hit level 7. He's not put a point into the Wukong's command just yet. He's actually chosen to max out the Boundless Strike as opposed to the Jingu Mastery, which seems kind of counterintuitive versus the Tide Hunter.
Top tower is on the rocks.
Yeah.
He's going for the Battle Fury. An absolute necessity this game in the face of Meepo. They have no AoE damage. The Monkey King is literally the only source of AoE damage that they're going to be bringing to the table. Red moves forward, throws down the overwhelming odds. He's going to slow things down on the top lane, but in the absence of his Blink.
I'm not sure what they need if they want to hold on. It's going to be 2 minutes until nighttime, so Dachi God isn't going to be doing too much. But it seems as if they're just going to give up that tier 1. Bakemono and Senjin still waiting though. They know that Red might go back into his own jungle. This could be another kill. Bakemono still not level 6. They haven't got the magnet.
Red's just in a compromising position.
But he's got a shrine. TP should be coming in. They should be punishing these two supports. But once again, the Radiant have no vision near their offlane. They're not even going to bother TPing.
Truthfully, if Bakemono connects with that rolling boulder, they actually end up dying themselves.
Yeah.
They went in without a Meepo. I just don't see Senjin and Bakemono scoring a solo kill on Red at this point.
Without Magnetize, without Glaives, it's hard.
They're even going to get the D ward that they just placed down there. So
they have smoke and they're moving towards the mid lane. Dazzle Husker. This is a tall ask of an Earth Spirit, a Silencer, and an Underfarmed
Wiper. You need a 2-man
wiper.
Boulder Smash and a 2-man Geomagnetic Grip if you want.
Is that going to be enough? You're going to get a 0-man Rolling Boulder. The range creep gets a heart attack.
Okay then.
Okay, casual smoke wasted. Let's go to another lane and do something useless now.
Is Engine didn't even break his smoke. See, this is where it starts to fall apart for Crusaders on most occasions, but they've sort of plugged that hole by having Invincible who's just being efficient and farming all the while.
Yeah.
And lackluster rotations coming out. They've got the Ravage online again. Maybe it's time to group up and take another building. Meepo, he's going towards the Blink Dagger. I think the call is you wait for the Meepo's Blink and then you try and take a fight with the Ravage once again.
Okay.
Right? He's just... Okay, never mind. They're both here itself. Remstar, piss poor this game, by the way. He's just got treads and a magic stick so far with the Ring of Aquila.
It's not tanky at all. Itachi God has smoked with Zark and Pashu. A kill on Meepo is exactly what they need. Invincible though. He's already got gold for his Blink Dagger. The Global Silence still not available. Darshan, I'm not sure if he can make it in time with the TP onto the tier 1. Pashu and Itachi God leading the charge. Bakemono gonna take the hit. Probably drops a Boulder Smash and a Geomagnetic Grip. Rolls away with the Rolling Boulder. Where was the lockdown? Where was the void coming out from the Night Stalker? Instead, they find Darshan. Darshan silenced with the Crippling Fear. Remstar's here with the break coming in from the Nether Toxin. He's running forward, moves on to Pashu. Pashu lifts his hand to drop the grave, doesn't get the chance. Zark controlled with the Boulder Smash. They're moving on to him. Can they cancel the DP? Invincible moves, starts, stop. Doesn't drop the Earthbinds.
Well, that still works out really well for Crusaders.
Yeah, Bakemono survives. They move on to mid. They're looking for more, but... Okay, I'm going to get it.
So, correct me if I'm wrong, but that was just one kill on the Dazzle, right?
Yeah, that was it. One kill on the Dazzle, Bakemono survived, and now they're transitioning this into a push. This is a push without the Ravage, and without a mech yet. Itachi God goes in, not sure what he was thinking. Invincible unveils his Link Dagger, gets a kill on the Night Stalker. Gonna make taking down the tier 1 easier. Zark jumps in, moves on to Remstar. The Geomagnetic Grip is there, the duel from Red. Secures his first dual victory damage and Bakemono just rolling boulders away. Darshan has to retreat, doesn't have the Ravage, doesn't have the mech. It's a Night Stalker for a Viper. And that's not even a trade.
Absolutely not. I feel like it's still sort of tilting in favor of Crusaders. Mostly because of Senjin just taking away intelligence time again. He hasn't even put a point into the glaive, so we have yet to see his final form.
Yeah.
Bakemono connects with the Boulder Smash that he really shouldn't have. Darshan doesn't have the Ravage available for another minute, so this isn't a tower they should be looking to contest, honestly. Zark's a bit low on HP, but that really works in his favor at this point. With the armlet, two bracers, and soon-to-be complete power treads, he is super tanky.
Yeah. I like what Invincible's got. He's decided that there isn't really a fight to participate in at the mid lane. And he's just gone back to farming. He's going for the Silver Edge.
It's not bad at all, actually. We talked
gonna
about
make
how
sure that the poop hurts versus the Husker?
Yeah.
Okay.
You've got the Silver Edge on the Meepo. You might have a Scythe of Ice coming out on him later as well.
Yeah.
I think Bakemono should be the one taking up the 5 position this game because clearly Senjin is starting to scale a bit better. Maybe give Senjin the farm priority and let
him just... What does Senjin farm? Atos? Bakemono, Rolling Boulder, does manage to clip onto Itachi, got the Boulder Smash whiff, the Geomagnetic Grip never came through, a Stone Remnant dropped on the floor.
Yeah, no, more than the Atos, I think you probably go for something like a Glimmer Cape.
Okay. But do you want Silence's Glimmer Cape or do you want Earth Spirit's Blink Dagger to follow up after the Ravage?
When you put it that way, obviously you want the Earth Spirit to follow up with the Blink Dagger, but when the Husker jumps in upon you, you want to have a Glimmer Cape to get the hell away from it.
Okay. Or maybe you will Ghost Scepters. And then this game becomes...
Ghost Scepters does seem... Actually, you're right. The Ghost Scepter seems better than the Glimmer Cape. And to that end, even a Solar Crest wouldn't be bad in all of these heroes. I just realized the only sources of magic damage in this game are from the Life Break, Burning Spears as well.
Life Break, the Night Stalker, the Legion. Not really.
Most of the damage that the Legion and the Husker are bringing is going to be physical. Faces a stiff win. It does make sense to go for the Ghost Sector slash Solar Crystal. Viper's going to be able to throw down the Drake in the trees. They're not going to deal anyone with it, and they're going to go for a 2-1. It does come at the cost of a tier 1.
Look at Invincible, though. He's leading to Roshan. And they had no idea what was going on. Hitachi God is, yeah, I think I spotted him out. The Rolling Boulder is perfect from Bakemono. Boulder Smash, Geomagnetic Grip, everything to control the Night Stalker. Senjin, once again, on the way to steal a little more intelligence. And that last Anchor Smash from Darshan seals the kill. They're looking for a trade. They don't feel comfortable just man-fighting against the Crusaders.
I mean, that sure, they lost a couple of towers on the mid and top lanes, but they end up getting a kill for the price of it. They get a Roshan instead of the tower, and they get a tier 1 tower on bottom. Crusader still comes out on top in that skirmish. Maybe they should consider contesting this top lane though.
Yeah, they've got Ravage. Itachi God is far away.
They most certainly could turn this into a 4 versus 5 with the Night Stalker dead for a while. Instead, they're just going for another tier 2 tower. And I'm wondering if they even consider just going for the base if you're on the side of Crusaders.
No.
They're the ones in the driver's seat. And with a Global Silence and a Ravage at the ready, I think you can.
I think you got a little bit carried away there. You've forgotten the quorum for going high ground.
Five Roshans.
Come on. Let's not forget the rules. Anyway, it seems like they're going high ground. They've got one Roshan. Why not? They've got Ravage as well. Let's push on up. Invincible goes in. Pashu graves himself. But the stun is there from the Earth Spirit. The press, the attack, bottoms in time. Remstar moving on to the Husker, keeping him controlled with the Viper Strike while they bring down Pashu. Itachi God wants to go in. Invincible, well, he's got Aegis and he goes right back. Pashu buys back. The Ravage is there. They managed to remove the Aegis from Meepo, but Husker is dead for 43 without buyback. It's a buyback though on the Legion Commander. And Legion Commander might be able to do some work here. The Boulder Smash and the control coming into the Earth Spirit isn't really available.
Oh,
the duel is there. He's caught Invincible. Invincible trying to keep that Meepo alive. In fact, he doesn't die. He just turns right back. Pashu right-clicking away on the Meepo that's low on HP. He's trying to poof away but will not be successful.
Third world micro problems there for Meepo. I think he poofed one of those Meepos on the exact same spot instead of poofing out, and that's why Legion Commander walked up and caught him. I may be mistaken about that, but he most certainly didn't micro the low HP Meepo out, instead sending him into tower attack range, and that finished him off. There was an interesting moment there. So the LC blinked into the fight, and before he could get a duel off,
Ravage.
The Ravage connected on him. So he was sent up into the air, he dies, he buys back, and then he comes back to fight. But that was essentially two buybacks expended to score a kill on the Meepo, which at this point in the game is really the only thing that they could have gotten on the side of Marksmen. Mm-hmm. But honestly, as we enter their last game, as we enter the tail end of this tournament here, Crusaders seem to be finding their stride. What a bittersweet moment for them.
Yeah, I mean, they are playing what is considered to be one of the stronger teams in the tournament in the Marksmen, and they're not doing too bad.
Yeah.
The Meepo pick has worked out. If only they had thought of doing this earlier.
Bottom lane though, Marksmen are not going to take this one lying down. Instead, they're going to group up and try and take a tier 1 of their own.
I think you give up that tier 1.
Yeah.
You don't give up the tier 2, you hope to find a trade in mid. And Invincible, I think it's about time he stops.
I actually think you give up the tier 2 as well, because
you're
fighting without a Ravage and a Global Silence. They know this.
Okay.
And that's why Marksmen are looking to start a fight.
Okay.
Problem is, Red is not here. And they don't know this.
I think they do.
Spider sense.
I saw Boulder Smash go in that direction. Now there's a Remnant lying here. I'm not sure if Bakemono knew he was there or not. So just kick the Boulder in that direction. Darshan is split push. He's doing the best he can. He doesn't have Ravage for 16 seconds. He's trying to find the tier 2 elsewhere. Mid lane, Red, not sure what he was thinking. Hoped Invincible would miss Micro. Now here comes Mage, controlled by the Viper Strike. He's got the Wukong's command. There's a Global Silence upon him. And they bring down the Monkey King. The Nether Toxin did help. Boulder Smash doesn't miss the clip. Pashu, are they looking for more? Invincible low on HP, not gonna chase. Pashu, eat himself up.
That was some top quality throw coming out from Marksman. They just TP'd in one after the other and got beat up. What the hell were they thinking?
Yeah, Monkey King TP'd in after the Legion Commander died.
I'm a little appalled at that, because that's something that doesn't even happen in our crappy tier pub games.
Yeah, that should be happening. Mismanaged TP is there. And when you TP to a tier 1, pretty much on any side of the map, you've got to respect the fact that the shrine is far away. People can't just TP and there's going to be delayed TPs. Sure, you're a Monkey King, but you're not stronger than 3 Meepos pounding away on you. And now they're going to the mid lane. You know, they've got the Ravage back up. They committed the Global Silence. Bakemono is still around.
Exactly. To add some perspective on this, the only window of opportunity that Crusaders have is when the Ravage and the Global Silence are on cooldown. At that point, you should be the one taking advantages in your favor, yeah. But instead they gave up two kills without the Ravage and the Global Silence. That's more devastating than I can possibly explain here.
Yeah. And now the Ravage is back up. So they didn't even get this tier 2 that they were pushing for. That's the bigger problem here. They TP to the mid lane to defend a tier 1, and it wasn't a very good defense. Instead they just ended up feeding away a couple of kills and Invincible still alive.
What happens when the Ghost Scepter start to come out, honestly?
It's going to be a huge problem. You've got to hope that life breaks, plus there's some form of control to hold them in place. Anyway, there's a life break. Dark has gone in, but he's gone into Senjin and Bakemono. The Ravage is there. They need to focus Asuka. The Nether Toxin is going to help. That's the attack. Going to buy him time. The overwhelming odds, still not enough. Darshan pops the mech, and the retreat is secured. Bakemono playing football with a monkey, kicks him back to the low ground, while Invincible finds Itachi God and finds the Legion Commander. Crusaders! They've found their stride. They've found their way to make their games work.
That's a duel victory for the Meepo. Legion thought he'd go and duel an isolated Meepo over there. Instead, Meepo brought his homies and he just decimated him there.
Look, I was going to try and rationalize that and say maybe Red with the blade mail might have been able to win that duel, but he didn't even have a blade mail. The marksman. I mean, other teams are going to capitalize on this. Who's playing the marksman? The Shedders? Yeah. If I'm not mistaken.
Tier 3 in jeopardy now. While there's no Ravage, there is a Global Silence.
They don't have Ravage, but Invincible is becoming a huge problem.
They have the Global Silence on Senjin though. He needs to stand back.
Zark is going to life break in. They need the Monkey Kick. Invincible trying to poop off. The Void is there. They've got one of the Meepos. But the Global Silence is there, buying the Meepo a little bit of time. Bakemono with the Magnetize. They lose the Meepo. They're trying to bring down the Night Stalker, but the Grave keeps him alive. A duel comes out onto the Titan. The Zark focuses attention upon Darshan. The Anchor Smash not going to reduce enough damage. And Darshan will finally fall. They lose the Tier 3. The range barracks still stand. It's a defense of sorts.
So, and fun fact, Zark hadn't turned on his Burning Spears for the majority of that fight. He was basically throwing toothpicks at them with no Burning Spears activated.
I mean, it's a defense, but I don't know. I mean, they kill the Tai, they kill the Meepo. Invincible could do better to stay alive. Keep a Meepo, try and poof him out during the Global Silence. You weren't dual. That was the situation he could have managed if he was not dual, and he didn't manage it very well.
Now Mage is hitting like a truck, by the way. He's got the Battle Fury as well as the Desolator finished up. His BKB is en route to. Slowly but surely, you are seeing a bit of a power spike coming back in favor of Marksmen.
Yeah.
They could be on the verge of a comeback.
You're also seeing a lot of pick-off potential coming out from the Meepo. He's got a Scythe of Ice. Still hasn't used it.
He did, actually. He did? So he got the Monkey King on the backline before he could jump in and start the fight. And with the Monkey taken out of the picture, it looked like it was going to be a successful team fight for them. Unfortunately for them, the Monkey wasn't really necessary when Zark was on the front lines and Red gets a good duel off. Maybe you just wait for the next Roshan. He's going to come back in the next 40 seconds and Meepo's the ideal candidate to take him down. That said, both sides have a lot of Roshan taking potential, so five Roshans may not cut it this game. It's probably going to be a few more.
If Pacho on the Dazzle gets up a good beam, that Monkey King is really going to hurt them. With Scan coming out from the Dire, it's read their movements rather well. And they're just grouped up, holding onto the high ground, while Invincible is pushing his three other Meepos to the bottom lane. They pretty much know where the marksmen are, and they could actually force them to TP back to defend their barracks and then move into Roshan. That's what Invincible should be doing now, forcing back TPs so that Roshan is an option. Instead, he was AFK in the jungle. It might have appeared as if our camera froze for a moment, but that was Invincible who froze for a couple. Anyway.
I mean, he's playing easy mode Meepo, man.
He should be sending those Meepos to the bottom lane. If the scan clipped, do they see Mage at top? No, they see Zark. It's a bit obvious that Husker is not going to split push without the Dazzle. Push bottom. force back TPs. Instead,
they did nothing.
They did nothing. And now they're moving to the rush pit. Okay, the good thing is that they didn't manage to reclaim vision around the rush pit, but the Monkey King can still be a problem.
They know this now. Itachi saw Bakemono. The nighttime vision is kicking in.
The pit, the weave did manage to attack at me for Bakemono. Boldness match, Geomagnetic Grip. They're trying to bring down the Night Stalker. Darshan blinks in, doesn't use the Ravage and Senjin. Gets more intelligence to work with. This is a fight without the Night Stalker. Invincible, his clones, and I don't know what he's doing with them. How do they start this fight?
Awkward moment there. Invincible wanted the Meepo. Invincible wanted the illusions for his Meepo.
Oh shit. More of an awkward moment.
Oh my god, what is going on here?
I think Bakemono saw this. He's walking in with the boldest man. He's excited at the opportunity he has. Now they caught Zark. The Dazzle, I don't know where he is. The Wukong's command, just a nice circle to look at on the ground, but Red without the duels isn't going to be doing too much. They get Aegis, they should get Cheese. And four teams have just immensely goofed up around the rush pit.
So for starters, it should have been Meepo picking up the illusion so that he had another alternative to goof to. Senjin picks it up and he says, I got this, fam. Sends an illusion up to Red. Red goes ahead and duels it. What? Man. This is the equivalent of Khan's dooming a creep yesterday. Maybe worse, in fact. No one does this
to me. He's got a couple of Meepo pushing at the bottom.
Bye, Mage.
He's farming Mage.
50 seconds, no Mage. Red wants to duel him, but he needs to be careful. Tide was... Darshan did a good thing there. He jumped in, evaluated the situation in a split second, and didn't Ravage.
Yeah, they have it for the high ground now. What's Darshan picked up since the mech? He's picked up the blink. I'd like to see a Crimson Guard.
They've got this. Darshan's basically going to go and beat up on these range barracks by himself.
Mm-hmm. Mid is pushing in as well. And Husker's trying to deal with the push coming out from the mid lane. But he's losing barracks in the bottom lane. The glyph not being committed. Invincible goes in, goofs up once more, moves back to the barracks.
Right, sights on cooldown.
They get the barracks.
Barracks have taken down.
Look, they have Ravage and Global Silence.
They can keep going.
The Crusaders are just cruising through victory here.
I really don't think they go back for shrines. You just take a fight.
I think Invincible's going in. He's trying to poof on top of someone, but there was no one there.
I mean, he's horribly misjudging the blink dagger distance here.
Anyway, they're moving to the mid lane. This should be the fight that decides the game. And when fights such as this are upon us, I've got five Crusaders.
They've got a sentry ward on the floor. It's going to get dewarded now, but they saw Invincible prepping to jump in there. But they should go. I think Invincible needs to jump and start the fight. If he can take out Pashu on the back line, that's it.
Overwhelming odds, boulders. There they go. They go in right on top of the Husker. Premature Grave, is it going to be enough? Invincible turns to the tier 3. Bakemono rolls in and Invincible brings down the Husker. The duel is there, takes away the Aegis while Itachi God manages to bring down the Earth Spirit. They're moving on to Remstar, but Itachi God can't really give chase. Ravage on cooldown, Meepo being controlled. Invincible scores the double, but Zark with the Grave will manage to bring down Invincible and moves on to bring down Darshan. Red giving chase, he's got the last word upon him. They want Remstar. Got the cheese. Wouldn't be too wise to pop it. He's trying to man up, but can't really do so. Pashu scores the kill.
Yeah, it cost them a buyback on the Huskar, but it works out for the best. They score four kills and they do end up losing their tier 3 tower. But now they're the ones pushing forward. We talked about this as well. Hey, did I just see Meepo dying again? I'm sorry, I had a brain fart moment there. The point is, there's four dead. There's no Meepo for 50 seconds. There's no Ravage available.
You got
for 90 seconds. If Marksmen don't push right now, we're going to see a repeat of what happened earlier on in the bottom lane, but this time on the middle lane. And they could die all they want. They're just going to take buildings and get on out again. I mean, let's face it. The Monkey King and the Huskar aren't the best at dealing with super creeps and mega creeps. Monkey King with his item build, perhaps he's got something to do with it.
Bakemono's gone in for Huskar.
What the hell was that?
Once again, he used the boulder smash and then kicked him? I didn't understand. That's not possible.
He stunned him, right?
And then was the Huskar 4-star? Maybe?
Yeah, I think it was a 4-star. Thank God it was a 4-star.
I lost faith in this game for a moment here.
I mean, I just facepalmed. My mind went to this really dark place about what's going on with Dota. But I'm glad it was a 4-star.
Anyway, they're grouping up once more. Remstar has the Radiance.
They've got a DD rune as well. I actually think you give it over to Viper and not the Meepo. Why does Remstar have a Radiance though? That's the real question.
When?
Zark.
I'm gonna try and keep my eyes on Remstar and exactly try and find out what he's doing in these fights. Just ends up surviving till the end and dying.
I mean, Radiance Viper is something I haven't seen in like 8 years. 6 years now, actually.
Remstar is something I haven't seen in 6 years.
What an idiot, Vivek. The game continues. The dinosaurs are
so
on the verge of one last victory before they die.
Do you think that makes it... The spell life?
Yeah, I guess that makes sense.
Ashen's LinkedIn.
I don't know, I still think a Veil would have been better, but
I agree, a Veil could have been better.
Anyway, they're back to finish what they started.
He could have built utility, you know, that's the funny bit. He could have built a Crimson Guard. They pop the glyph, they're running in after Remstar. Let's see.
Well, that's a bad glyph.
Yeah, that is. There was no creep there. And they committed a void and pushed the Huskar forward. So the glyph hasn't done too much. The creep wave's coming through. Zark is trying to deal with it. Remstar could be a little bit more judicious with the use of the Nether Toxin. Boulder Smash on the Zark. This is when you need that Nether Toxin, but they're not gonna. There it is. Break applied, but no damage. Itachi got trying to deal with the push coming in from the bottom lane that already takes away a third of his HP.
So Viper is deceptively good versus the Huskar for two reasons. One is he's got the control.
Oh, duel. How good is this Viper? You've got the Ravage, you've got the mech. That's going to keep Viper alive.
Yes,
and this
cheese.
Doesn't mean that Legion could fall. Immediate cheese pop, otherwise that Boundless Strike would be the end of him. Meepo in the midst of battle, trying to deal with the Monkey King, will be able to, but Husker's third. The Boulder Smash they missed, and Invincible trying to TP out.
Oh, he got out?
Red
he left one though.
He pops press the attack. Invincible is still alive. The Glimmer Cape doing work. He's popping the poof, but he's got to respect the Blade Mail. It's still enough. Invincible survives. And finally, for the first time in the entirety of this tournament, we see the Crusaders being the one yelling at the opponents.
It's such a sad moment though, because they're screaming and nothing is really happening. They're trying so hard to rally support, but
it's an
inconsequential match. Marksmen are... Unfortunately, they're still the victors of this game. The GG comes out. Crusaders will win the battle, but the war has been won by Marksmen. They're still moving on to the semi-finals, but the Crusaders can take some pride in their exit match on Ucypher stage for Season 1.